Hi, thank you. I only realized afterwards how oddly fitting this title is. And if you don't know what V8 is, it's the... It's the JavaScript engine that powers both Chrome and Node.js. And V8 has two important components inside of it, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. And that is the interpreter Ignition and the compiler Turbofan. And those shipped in Chrome 59, so a little over a year ago. And these two components work together in an intricate way, and that's what this talk is going to be about. So Ignition and Turbofan have different performance characteristics. So Ignition has a very fast startup time, and it produces very small bytecode. So that means Ignition for executing JavaScript is ideal when you execute code at page load and for infrequently executed code, because you don't want to spend a lot of memory on that. On the other hand, Turbofan is an optimizing compiler, and Turbofan is able to generate very, very fast machine code. But this machine code will have to make optimistic assumptions to be worth the compilation, the time you spend compiling. And Turbofan excels at code that you execute frequently, because then it can pay off the compile time. And it excels at code that's executed after page load, because you don't want to immediately start compiling when you're still struggling to get the first impression up. Okay, so these two components work together. They have different performance characteristics, and they achieve peak performance for your JavaScript code. So now the question is, how exactly does the interaction between these components look like? And I don't want to talk about when Ignition decides to compile stuff, but I want to talk about how the interaction looks like. So I'm going to walk you through the compilation of a very simple function, namely a JavaScript function that maps x to x plus 1. And on this side, I have Ignition. And on this side, I have Turbofan. And now we're going to see how a round trip between these two looks like. So in V8, if you execute JavaScript, the first thing that happens is that Ignition gets your JavaScript code. And Ignition will gather type feedback while it executes the code. So let's assume that you always pass in a number to this function. And you call it often, so that the heuristic in Ignition triggers and says, we need to compile this code. It's now worth it. So then Ignition detects hot code and passes this function together with the type feedback about x to Turbofan. And then Turbofan will make an optimistic assumption. It will generate code just for the case that x is a number. And this is important. And we will see later in the talk in detail what this means. So then we end up with machine code, actually, for this function. And this machine code will have checks in it. It will make sure that every time it's called, its argument is actually a function. And then the machine code is executed happily until maybe you call this function with, say, a string. And then the optimistic assumption turns out to be wrong. OK, this can happen in JavaScript. You can pass all things to all functions. And then we have to get rid of this code because it doesn't know how to deal with the string. And we let Ignition resume the execution. So now at the point where we detect that the argument doesn't have the type we expected, we pass execution to Ignition. And Ignition now also sees this execution where x is a string, and it's able to reconcile the type feedback. So now Ignition knows, OK, this function might be called with numbers or strings, and the circle can start anew. And this upper arc is called optimization, so going from ignition to turbofan. And the lower arc is called de-optimization. And de-optimization is not per se a bad thing. It is just the result of ignition not having a crystal ball to guess the right types for everything you compile. So sometimes when the assumptions we made turn out to be wrong, we have to de-optimize, update our assumptions, and start anew. And this will happen when you run a page. It's completely normal, as long as it doesn't happen too often. So now I want to talk a little bit about type feedback and why type feedback is so important for turbofan. And again, I will be looking at compiling this simple function. So now, suppose that we don't know anything about x, and we want to know what do we have to do to implement plus. And plus in JavaScript is tricky, you know, because it adds numbers, but it also concatenates strings. And then depending on objects, left and right, it can have a lot of different meanings. And this is reflected in the JavaScript spec, where you see that there are a lot of primitives, like toPrimitive and toString, that you have to implement if you want to implement plus. And each of those has, again, a lot of things that need to be done. So if you want to implement plus, you have to have code for all of these cases. So if you look at what ignition does when it has to translate the simple program, then we are actually in pretty good shape. We produce 7 bytes of bytecode because all the complexity is in the bytecode instruction add. And this bytecode instruction implements the whole spec from before. So that's why this code is very small, but it also means that this add has some performance overhead because it has to provision for all those cases. If you do the same thing with turbofan, assuming that you don't have any type information about x, then you're at 140 bytes, so it depends on how you count. In reality, it's even more because there's some bookkeeping involved. And then you get this machine code. And you can see there's some bookkeeping even in the machine code. So we first have to check whether the function that was called is already marked for de-optimization. Then we have to check whether we have a breakpoint set. We have to have code that handles the breakpoint by calling into the runtime. We have the actual function code, and then we have some de-optimization bailouts. And the point here is now this instruction. It's a call, again, to the add built-in, because turbofan doesn't know anything about the type, so it also has to implement all of these things. So the trade-off we're making here doesn't make a lot of sense, because we're spending a lot of memory, but in the end, we're not really more efficient than what ignition could provide us with. On the other hand, if we know that x is a number, then already at the spec level, we know that a lot of things just can't happen. So we can cross out these things, and we don't have to implement them. We don't have to generate code for them. And in this case, turbofan can be a lot more efficient, because now we spend some memory on the code, but we don't have a call anymore. We just have a test whether the input is still a number, and then we have an actual add instruction, which adds the plus one to the integers. And this is a better trade-off, because now you get performance for spending more memory. Okay, so what is the important point to realize? The important point to realize is that if in turbofan code generation we can't cross out large parts of the spec, then we're not really getting fast code. And to cross out large parts of the spec, we have to have speculative assumptions. And that's where the type feedback comes in. Because the type feedback tells us, hey, this x has always been a number. You don't need to implement these things. And that's where Turbofan gets its performance boost from. So up to now, I have used these words types and type feedback. And I wanted to clarify a little bit what I really mean by that. And to talk about this, I wanted to start from a different end, namely, what does it actually mean that V8 provides an environment for a safe language? So what makes JavaScript a safe language? And there are many definitions of safe language you can give. But for this talk, let's run with no matter what you do in JavaScript, the VM doesn't crash. So this is one definition you can have. There are others that are more interesting and also important, but let's run with this one in this talk. And that actually means that the worst thing you get is probably a type error or reference error in your dev console, and you don't see or snap if you do programming mistakes in JavaScript. And now think about what the JavaScript VM has to do to actually make your language safe. And the answer is it has to do a lot of dynamic runtime checks. So, for example, if you access an array, and maybe some of you has experience in C or C++, then JavaScript just can't let you access the 10th element of A. It has to check that A is actually an object or an array to mean what to find out what the brackets mean, and it has to make sure that you're in bounds and otherwise give you undefined. And it does this to keep the to keep the language safe. Other things are if you access a field foo of x, then JavaScript has to go and has to look at x. Does x have a field foo? What about the prototype? And so on. And to do all these checks, the values that are behind your variables are tagged dynamically in the JavaScript runtime. That means that each value notes its, what I call in this talk, dynamic shape. So A knows it's an array, and A knows its length. And because A knows these things, the JavaScript VM can decide what to do when we access the 10th element. Similarly, X knows that it's an object. It would also know that it's if it was a number, and so on. So when I used types in this talk previously, then what I really meant was that the dynamic shape of these objects in JavaScript. So here are some examples of dynamic shapes that V8 internally tracks. So for example, for small integers, we have our own shape. Then for floating point numbers, we have a shape. For JS objects, we don't only have one shape, but a wealth of them. For regular expressions, we have our own shape. For functions, we have our own shape. And then, for example, for this object literal, we would have a shape that says, this is an object with a property foo, and so on. And these shapes internally determine how the VM handles these values. And now we can finally understand what type feedback is. Namely, type feedback is just the set of dynamic shapes V8 has seen at some point during execution. So, for example, here, V8 tracks all the shapes it sees for X. So it can tell, for example, that X is always an object which has a field foo. And in turn, the optimizing compiler can make the assumption that you always get objects in that have this field foo, thereby striking out cases from the specification and enabling a more efficient implementation. However, V8 doesn't have type feedback for everything, because type feedback isn't for free. You have to record it when you execute it, and you have to have a place to store it. And as you can have a lot of code, you can have even more type feedback. So we are making a trade-off to record type feedback that we think is valuable, and other type feedback that turns out not to be as valuable, we don't record to save performance and memory. Okay, so the last remark I can make about type feedback here is that the gathering of feedback, so remembering which shapes you have seen for X, is purely for performance reasons. This isn't needed for security. And it also gives ignition more performance because the bytecode can kind of expect what the next value will be that it sees. Okay, and now since I've used the word type a lot in this talk, I wanted to have a slide where I compare this to TypeScript and make clear that the TypeScript types and the types I've been talking about serve completely different purposes. So the TypeScript types are actually static types, and they are assigned to variables in the program text, while the types I was talking about are really the dynamic shapes of values and of the values at runtime, and not necessarily of the, and they are not known at compile time already. And also the purpose of these things are different, because the static types in TypeScript help you to use your abstractions consistently, while the dynamic shapes of the values in V8 help to ensure safety and through the tracking mechanism also provide type feedback for performance. Okay, so let me summarize what we have seen in the talk up to now. We have two performance tiers, ignition and turbofan, and these two interact via optimization and de-optimization. And ignition might realize it has some code that's getting executed over and over again, and it knows type feedback, so it passes the type feedback over to turbofan, and then the turbofan code gets executed until one of the assumptions fails. And when one of these assumptions fails, for example, X was assumed to be a number, but now we see a string, we're throwing away the code and we're de-optimizing, and ignition is able to reconcile the type feedback. And because we learn in every round trip, this can't go on forever. But now I want to talk about a detrimental case which can occur in a VM, but not because you did something wrong, but we in the V8 team had an oversight, and that's called an infinite deopt loop. And an infinite deopt loop happens if you go around this circle without learning. So an infinite deopt loop is always a failure to learn. And now I'm going to walk you through an example where we fail to learn, and the example will be about the charcode add function. So as I mentioned earlier, we don't have dedicated argument feedback for the argument for position. So we actually don't know what the type of pos is from feedback. But it turns out often it's reasonable to assume that pos is a valid index into the string charcode add is called on. And that's actually something nice which we want to speculate that it's the case. Because if we know that pos is a valid index, then the return of charcode add will be a small integer, the charcode of the character at that position. And we can use that information to optimize more. So we want to make this speculative assumption that you're actually passing a valid index into charcode add, but we don't have a feedback vector where it could update if this speculative assumption fails. So for example, suppose you have a parser, and somewhere in the parser you call charcode add to get the charcode of the character at a certain position. So now turbofan will assume that pos is a valid index to get out that c is a small integer. And now suppose that at some point we're passing, during execution of the optimized code, we're passing a position that is actually not a valid index. So now we have to de-optimize. Of course, there's a check in it that checks this. But we can't transport this information to the next compile. And so the next time the parser gets hot, We go into optimization again, and we make the same assumption, which already once turned out to be wrong, and so we are falling in the same trap again, and we end up with a huge performance penalty. So we have a general protection mechanism, which stops the optimization circle after a number of times. When we realize, oh, we're going around this too often, let's not optimize this function again. And what I implemented in the beginning of this year is a new mechanism to solve this issue. And that is a marker we can place at a specific call. So with this mechanism, if we compile again, we make the assumption, we get the de-optimization, but now upon de-optimization, we actually place a sticker on this precise call, and this sticker means that the next time you compile the function, don't make any speculative assumptions. Don't make any assumptions that aren't backed up by feedback vectors. And now with this sticker, if we optimize the next time, we're not going to make this assumption, and we don't get the deopt loop. And this is actually even better, because it means that you might lose a little bit of performance, because we can't have the fast path for charcode add, but the rest of the function gets still optimized by TurboFan. Whereas in the case before, the whole function parser was marked as don't optimize this function again. Okay, so to summarize, we have this flag to disable optimization. And this enables V8 to make assumptions that aren't backed out, that aren't backed up by feedback, but often reasonable to make. And we have quite a few of those. And if an assumption gets violated, we can put a sticker on that precise call and say, don't make any of these speculative assumptions that are not backed up by feedback vector. And this prevents deopt loops with minimal performance penalty. So now I want to talk a little bit about array built-ins and why array built-ins are fast. So these are the array built-ins that are intended to help you write less for loops with indices. And I will have an example where I will use an array and where I will need type feedback for the array. I will use this in the optimization example. And so let's just say we have a dynamic shape which is called number array. So that means that we have an array with numbers in it. If you want to know more about number arrays, there is a talk on elements kinds by my colleague, which you can look up. And the array built-in I want to look at is reduce. And reduce allows you to fold over an array with the reduction function, which tells us how to obtain the next value of B. And you can start with an initial value of B. So this call will apply this function to 0 and 1, and then the result to 2, and then the result again to 3, ultimately summing up the numbers in the array. And now let's walk through how TurboFan optimizes the function foo, which does nothing else but call reduce. So in a first approximation, TurboFan will replace this reduce by code that looks like this. And in this code, we see that the function, the step function, is actually a constant. And we can start optimizing out this condition, whether the step function is actually a function, because we see the constant. And we can even go further and inline f down here. And to optimize this function more, we need to have use the speculative assumption that we know that A is a number array. So the first thing we have to do is we have to insert runtime checks. So the first check we have is immediately after the function is called, we will check that A is still a number array, otherwise we'll deoptimize. And I will need another check in the loop because we haven't analyzed what this expression is doing. Remember, it's coming from the function f, which is user provided. So in theory, the user could have done something to change the dynamic shape of A. For example, pushing a string into it. So if A isn't a number array after this operation, I also need to deoptimize. And now I can use the assumption that A is actually a number array in optimization, and the first thing I can get rid of is actually checking that the key is actually in A, because number arrays, let's assume shapes number array are dense, that means that from 0 to length, all to length minus 1, all indices are actually numbers in the array. Knowing that, we know that if we read AI, this is going to be a number. So this whole thing is going to be a number add. Now we know that the number add can't touch A, so we can get rid of this check again. And we are left with this one. Sorry, this should say number here. And that looks pretty good, right? That's what you would write by hand, except for the dynamic check for the shape. So let's look at a performance comparison. So what we're actually comparing is A reduced to this handwritten code. And before I show you the results, I want to talk a little bit about how I benchmarked. So the first thing is that you should choose a workload that actually matters for you. And in the current world with an event loop or a microtask queue, you probably are interested in not large amounts. So if you're computing for 5 seconds and benchmarking that, then maybe that's not realistic because you can't grab a thread on a web page and have it compute for 5 seconds. Then what you also shouldn't do is you shouldn't make your workload too small, and you should counteract this by measuring repeated runs. Because performance.now or new date have overhead themselves, and you don't want to have a benchmark that essentially measures the performance of new date or performance now. So what I did is I repeated my benchmark for 10,000 times and measured the time of that. And then wrapping around this, I averaged again here only over 100 runs because I was impatient. You could easily use 1,000 runs here. And that's also important because the variance of these virtual machines is usually quite high. So you need to repeat things to actually get a reliable number. Okay, and these are performance numbers from 1 year ago, M60, in July 2017. And as you can see, 1 year ago, the array build-in implementation in V8 wasn't really competitive with the handwritten loops. But now, 1 year later, most of them are quite close to what you would write by hand. And so there is a little bit of a very small gap for map and for each, but the other ones are already looking pretty good. And that means you should feel free to use the array built-ins when you see fit for them. So performance probably isn't a reason why you should stay away from them. And another reason why you should use array built-ins is because I think this just looks less readable than this expression, even if a.filter will duplicate the array. But the question you can ask yourself is, do you really need to avoid this copy? Is this performance critical code? And if you don't know, maybe choose readability over premature optimization. A second thing, and that's why this diagram is here, is that if you're not careful with such things, you actually get a performance penalty. So without measuring juice readability. So the takeaway from my talk is write idiomatic modern JavaScript, use array built-ins where you see fit, and let the engines worry about performance. And of course, reach out to us if something is wrong by either tweeting at our team, at me, or by filing a Chrome bug. If you file a Chrome bug and you have a benchmark, that's super great. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we got some questions.
Okay.
How to write the fastest JavaScript? In summary, but yes, what's the best way to take advantage of optimizations? Is there any particular style that is better for optimizations?
Yeah. So we've been in this world where crankshaft script was a thing, and we don't want to get back there. So what you should do is you should write modern JavaScript. Modern might mean something now and something else in a year. You should always write the modern JavaScript. And if it's slow, then complain. And then we're going to make it fast. And this is the only reasonable way we can move forward, because there are many different browsers. And if people have to optimize for each browser, that's not going to work.
Right.
And we are committed to supporting you in.
Yeah.
In that, yeah.
All right. Is there any disadvantage in optimizations when using for of?
I didn't have for of in my talk. No, feel free to use for of. And again, it should be, yeah, for of should have great performance. And if it doesn't, it's a bug. Write a small benchmark and file it to us.
All right, will null check and index checks stop TurboFan from de-optimizing? Will it make it slower?
Do you mean if you write your...
In your own code, yeah.
What do you mean by index checks?
All right. Basing
so you mean whether you check whether your index is inbounds or... So no, if you check whether your index is inbounds, that won't stop TurboFan.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Nothing, no code you can write will prevent TurboFan from optimizing. TurboFan can compile the whole JavaScript language. But TurboFan has inside several tiers of optimization it can apply. And there are certain things that prevent it to going inside TurboFan to the fastest tier. So again, if you have an example where you write something and you really think that's reasonable and it's considerably slower than convoluted code that you can use to replace it, then file a bug.
All right. What are some of the most interesting things that you're working on now?
What are the most interesting things I'm working on now? Yeah, so I've only been in the VA team for 6 months, and I've not done JavaScript work before. So I'm learning new things. I learned about NPM. I learned about Node.js. And we have actually an internal tool which is written in JS, which we use to visualize debugging output for V8. And I'm always reading code and improving that tool to learn more about JavaScript and Node and how to set up things, and I found that pretty exciting.
Yeah.
And there's, of course, the technical work on V8, which is great.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. I think we're ready. Are we? Oh, okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thanks.